Let's hear it. Round of applause for members of the Somerville High School Band. They're led by Jacob Gabrizecki, and on the drum line, and Mark Heacox from the Kennedy School Music Music Department. You guys are fantastic. Oh, good morning. Happy Patriots Day.
Good morning.
On behalf of the City of Somerville, the Somerville Board of Aldermen, our colleagues on the school committee, and of the state delegation, my name is Joe Curtatone. I have the honor and the privilege of being the mayor of this great city. And we want to welcome you back to Foss Park and historic Somerville as we celebrate our city's history, our nation's origin, as part of Paul Revere's ride. Certainly the weather gods have blessed us today. But again, we want to thank you for being here to celebrate what is really the greatest moments in Paul Revere's Midnight Ride. We'll get to see Paul Revere in just a bit while we reenact the events of that historic day in April 1775. We honor his sacrifice as well as the sacrifice of the countless other men and women who shaped our nation. It's important that we recognize the deeper meaning and significance that day has across our region and for us right here in Somerville. Patriots Day is a day of courage, of pride, tradition, and resiliency. This year, Patriots Day celebration is particularly special because, as many of you may know by now, this year, Somerville celebrates its 175th birthday. And while Somerville's rich history and contributions to our nation may have started long before we were an independent town or city, now they have certainly continued since we officially separated from Charlestown on March 3rd, 1842. Now for the past 175 years, Somerville has embodied the spirit of Patriots Day that we celebrate today. So on this momentous day, and during this momentous year, we take the time as a community to remember who we are and to remember that Somerville's history is a crucial piece of our country's history. So again, I want to thank you for coming out to celebrate with us today. Enjoy today's events. Now I'd like to bring up, after I secure the microphone, my colleague in city government, the Ward 1 Alderman, to also offer welcome remarks, Mr. Matt McLaughlin.
Hey, good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming out on this beautiful day. Usually just read the proclamation, but I'm happy to see everyone here on Patriots Day. And give a shout out to my brother Danny and Billy Consolo, who are running the Boston Marathon today for Team Crystal Campbell. And we'll be going after that, so thank you everyone for coming. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you, Alderman. Now allow me a moment to introduce some of our other colleagues and distinguished guests. From the Board of Aldermen, the President of the Board of Aldermen, Alderman at Large, William White. From Ward 2, Alderman Marianne Houston. From Ward 3, Alderman Bob McWaters. Alderman at Large, Mary Jo Rossetti. Alderman at Large, Mr. Jack Connolly. From the School Committee in Ward 5, Ms. Laura Patone. And from our state delegation, our state representative right here in this area, and actually for Ward 4 folks, Ms. Christine Barber. But also, let's give a special welcome, the Mayor Emeritus. I remember participating in the celebration while he was Mayor, Mayor Eugene Brune. I'd also like to welcome, I saw him in the crowd, I think he's on stage, the best police chief in these United States, Chief Dave Fallon. And from his command staff, Captain James Donovan. Thank you for the work you do, Chief, Captain. At this time, please welcome the Executive Director of the Somerville Historic Commission, Ms. Brandon Wilson. We're going to have to... Just hold that side.
Good morning, and what a wonderful day that we have today. I feel very blessed that for once in the many years we've been doing this, that actually it's a beautiful day. A little windy, but other than that, just so hold on to your hats and caps. So welcome today to, as the mayor said, a historic occasion. I just want to briefly tell you that this event is sponsored by the City of Somerville in cooperation with the Somerville Museum. The director here is here today, which is Evelyn Battinelli. She's over at the podium, at the refreshment table. As well as Historic Somerville, which is a local group here in the city. And Eileen Schofield is over there as well. She's dressed up as the president. As well as Barbara Mangum, who is the founder of Historic Somerville, is now the president of the Board of Trustees for the Somerville Museum. And lastly, but hardly least, is East Somerville Main Street, which is here today representing themselves at this table back here where the passports are. They're an integral group to this area of the city in terms of getting businesses and residents more involved in their community. So Teresa is here behind me, I think, as well as some people at the table there. So thank you so much, everybody, for coming. I hope you all take advantage of the refreshments that, as you might have guessed by now, are all ones that might have been served in the 1700s. The purpose of today's event is actually to have people go back in history, think a little bit about what it was like if you lived in the 1700s. And that's why we're wearing what some people might call this funny clothing, as well as the refreshments and the games that the kids are playing, which were from simpler times, and many would say maybe more interesting times. So again, thank you so much. We have a little bit of a program planned for you for some readings that will be starting with some students that are in the local schools here. First, we're going to ask Alderman McLaughlin if he could read the proclamation from the governor himself.
Very good. A proclamation. Whereas throughout the evening of April 18th, 1775, Paul Revere and William Dawes rode through the countryside from Boston to Concord, informing the local militias that the British had mobilized and were headed to seize and destroy militia weapons and ammunition in Concord. And whereas, by the early morning of April 19th, 1775, the local Minuteman and the British Army had gathered on the Lexington Green, where the shots heard round the world was fired, and 8 Minutemen were killed, thus resulting in a retreat as the British continued on to Concord. And whereas at Concord, at North Bridge, a skirmish broke out, which caused the British casualties and attempted British retreat back to Boston that had failed as a result of the Minuteman resistance. And whereas the battles of Lexington and Concord marked the beginning of the long struggle for American independence from Britain. And whereas today we remember and pay tribute to the patriots who gave their lives in pursuit of liberty and independence. Now I, therefore, Charles D. Baker, Governor of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, do hereby proclaim April 18th, 2017, to be Patriots Day, and urge all the citizens of the Commonwealth to take cognizance of the event and participate fittingly in its observance. Given the Executive Chamber in Boston, this first day of April in the year 2017, and of the independence of the United States of America, the 241st. His Excellency, Charles D. Baker.
Thank you. All right, folks, Paul Revere is coming, so if you're going to come say hi to Paul, get on that side or here. We're going to keep the middle of the street clear. Paul's obviously leading a much healthier lifestyle because he skipped the Mount Vernon. So. All right, and when we see him coming down, the Somerville High School Band is going to welcome some music. And here's the key to get Paul and his beautiful horse to stay is to give him a big Somerville welcome when he comes. So we'll hear from the Somerville High School Band, and let's get everybody gathered up here along McGrath Highway here.
Just make sure they stay around.
And afterwards, folks, we'd ask you to please stay around because there's some amazing students who are going to recite some important historical poems, and let's give them our attention afterwards. But let's gather up for Paul. Band, you've got the stage.
Here he is, folks.
a big summer welcome to Paul Revere. We need to make some way off to the side here. Let's get to the sidewalk, please. Let's hear it for Paul. Here for Commander Rialli. Today, I love coming to Somerville because you guys all show a lot of support. You all come out. You're all part of my compatriots. You're patriots. You know, we have to remember on a day like today, when we think about the beginning and the colonial period of the patriots of that time, but we also got to remember the patriots of our time. We've got a lot of service people in the military representing us and protecting us all over the world, sacrificing a lot, time with their family, and on occasion their lives. So today, I'd like you to remember them as I do, as patriots. Just a quick thing. I'm with the National Lancers, some of you may know. We've been riding, doing the, oh, I'm out of breath, I'm so sorry. Heavy coat, hot day. We've been reenacting the Paul Revere ride since 1903. So it's been one of our missions. We're part of the military division of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, which means that we fall under the National Guard. So when we're not doing Paul Revere and William Dawes reenactments, you'll see us out on parade in our red uniforms. We do riots and search and rescues, anything that the governor or the adjutant general calls upon us to do. I'd like to give a quick thank you to the Massachusetts State Police for all their contributions and efforts today, getting us here safe. And of course, Somerville's finest, we're always out in full force, picking us up and bringing us through town. We could not do it without them. Thank you. Oh, Mr. Mayor, if it's all right, we'd like to spend a few minutes for some pictures.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Just tell them the rules, yeah?
Yeah. Everybody knows what I'm doing, right? Yeah. Everybody knows who I am? I'm looking at some small legs out there. I'm Paul Revere. Okay, if you didn't know, I'm Paul Revere. Can anybody tell me how many lanterns Robert Newman hung in the belfry of the Old North Church?
There's a poem readers right there.
Oh, okay. Did we already read the poem?
No, they're going to do that.
Okay, great. So I won't ruin it. I won't ruin it. Yeah. And then also in the poem, you're going to find out that I borrowed a horse in Charlestown. Yeah, by a guy named by Deacon Larkin. He lent me his horse, a Narragansett Pacer. Now, I know you guys know this because I ask you every year. What was my horse's name? What was it? Black Beauty. Really close. Brown Beauty. All right. All right. So Deacon Larkin told me that there was 9 British officers on the Medford Road, and I should be concerned, and to avoid them on my way to warn Mr. Adams and Mr. Hancock at the Clark House.
I was commissioned by Dr. Joseph Warren to warn them of the impending troop movements in Boston. That's my primary mission, to warn those two guys. And then once I warn them, I plan to go to Concord, because I fear that the British regulars are going out to Concord to get our ammunition supplies. I don't know if I'm going to make it. I'm going to try. Okay, we're going to hang around for a few minutes, get some pictures, listen to the troopers with the horses, stay in front of the horses, do not go behind them, and then we're off to Medfordtown. My horse's name, portraying Brown Beauty today, is Grant. Now keep in mind, he's in character, so he may not respond to Grant. You may have to call him Brown Beauty.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Let's hear it for Commander Reale, a.k.a. Paul Revere for the day. So he's graciously said, you know, I'm going to stick around for a few minutes, let the kids come around and take pictures. We ask that you give space to Grant, a.k.a. Brown Beauty, and the other horse with him. And then the commander will have to make his way to Medford. I do have, only because they took the time to write an official communication greetings to myself, the mayor of the city, and the people of Somerville on Patriots Day 2017, which reads, we exchange proclamations at this point from Boston and Somerville, from Boston to Somerville, Somerville to Medford. And this one reads, my fellow citizens and friends, in the spirit of Patriots Day, I'm delighted to join with you in celebrating the memory of our forefathers, where the roots of American democracy, industry, and culture first began, continue to flourish through their succeeding generations. Today, as we enter a new and exciting era in our city's history, we find a renewed sense of pride, patriotism, and vitality. From our vibrant downtown district, marked by the architectural wonders and very historic landmarks such as Faneuil Hall and Old Moore Church, to the distinctive charm of our neighborhoods, this energy and optimism is evident throughout the city of Boston. As Paul Revere and William Dawes once again ride out of Boston, let their message bespeak of the continuation of their revolution. We are proud of our heritage and of our world-renowned academic, financial, and overall institutions, but we are even more proud of the people who have grown to form the foundation of a very unique and exciting city. May Patriots Day 2017 and the 242nd be a most memorable, exciting day for you all. My warmest regards, Martin J. Walsh, Mayor of Boston. Thank you, Mayor Walsh, for your greetings. Let's give the mayor a round of applause. Yay!
Okay, so I'm very delighted to be able to welcome the three poem readers today. And we're going to start out with Ruth Anna Kern, who is from the Healy School in the fifth grade. And she's going to be reading The House by the Side of the Road. And the reason that we read this poem, it's a little tough, and so she's wonderful in doing this, is because Sam Walter Foss is the author. He lived from 1858 to 1911. And he was born in rural New Hampshire. His mother died when he was only 4 years old, so he had to grow up very quickly and to do chores on the family's farm. He only went to school in the wintertime because of this. However, he was still able to go to college, and he attended Brown University, where he graduated in 1882. He was a very popular poet. He wrote prolifically, as many as one poem a week for a local newspaper. And during his lifetime, he actually published 5 volumes of poetry. The poem that's going to be read today was his best known and loved poem. And he became the long-standing librarian at the Somerville Public Library. He married a minister's daughter and attended the Methodist Church on College Avenue, which, as you may know, is still there with a new denomination. His wife and he had a daughter and a son. And interestingly, this very park, which is once simply known as Broadway Park, was renamed to Foss Park in 1921 to honor their son, whose name is Saxon Connaught Foss, as we know it as Foss Park. Saxon, the son, graduated from Harvard College in 1910. He served in World War I and unfortunately was fatally wounded at the age of 30. He was honored with a Distinguished Service Cross in 1918 for the extraordinary heroism that he demonstrated in action in France. So today we're going to have the poem read by Sam Walter Foss, the father, by Ruth Ann Kern. So if she could come up, that'd be great.
I will be reading today The House by the Side of the Road. There are hermit souls that live withdrawn in a place of their self-content. There are souls like stars that dwell apart in the fellowless firmament. There are pioneer souls that blaze the paths where the highways never ran. But let me live by the side of the road and be a friend to man. Let me live in a house by the side of the road where the race of men go by. The men who are good and the men who are bad, as good and as bad as I. I would not sit in the scorner's seat nor hurl in the cynic's ban. Let me live in the house by the side of the road and be a friend to man. I see from my house by the side of the road, by the side of the highway of life, the men who press with the ardor of hope, the men who faint with the strife. But I turn not away from their smiles and tears, both parts of an infinite plan. Let me live in a house by the side of the road and be a friend to man. I know there are brook-gladdened meadows ahead and the mountains of wearisome heights, that the road passes on the long afternoon and stretches away to the night. And I still rejoice when the travelers rejoice and weep when with the strangers that moan, nor live in the house by the side of the road like a man who dwells alone. Let me live in the house by the side of the road where the race of men go by. They are good, they are bad, they are weak, they are strong, wise, foolish. So am I. Then why should I sit in a scorner's seat or hurl in a cynic's ban? Let me live in my house in the side of the road and be a friend to man.
Awesome, awesome.
She has a second career in mind, obviously. It's a tough poem to read, so thank you so much, Ruth Ann. She'll be back, Ruth Anna, in a minute. So now we're going to have the poem that I'm sure all of you have heard before, and Paul Revere will know that this is in a memory of him, or in honor of him, I should really say. And this poem, The Midnight Ride of Paul Revere, is going to be read by Jamie Da Silva and Derek Sebastio. And they are both Agenzianos students in the 6th and 7th grade. And they are going to go back and forth reading the stanzas for us today. So if you come on up, that'd be great.
We will be reading The Midnight Ride of Paul Revere by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. Listen, my children, and you shall hear of the midnight ride of Paul Revere. On the 18th of April in 75, hardly a man is now alive who remembers that famous day and year. He said to his friend, "If the British march by land or sea from the town tonight, hang a lantern aloft in the belfry arch of the North Church Tower as a signal light. One if by land and two if by sea, and I on the opposite shore will be ready to ride and spread the alarm through every Middlesex village and farm for the country folk to be up and to arm." Then he said good night with a muffled oar, silently rode to the Charlestown shore just as the moon rose over the bay, where swinging wide at her moorings lay the Somerset British man of war, a phantom ship which each mast and spar across the moon like a prison bar, and a huge black hulk that was magnified by its own reflection in the tide.
Meanwhile, his friend through alley and street wanders and watches with eager ears, till in the silence around him he hears the muster of men at the barrack door, the sound of arms, the tramp of feet, and the measured tread of the grenadiers marching down to their boats on the shore. Then he climbed the tower of Old North Church by the wooden stairs with stealthy tread, to the belfry chamber overhead and startled the pigeons from their perch on the somber rafters that round him made masses and moving shapes of shade. By the trembling ladder, steep and tall, to the highest window in the wall, where he paused to listen and look down at a moment on the roofs of the town and the moonlight flowing over all.
Beneath, in the churchyard, yea, the dead, in their night encampment on the hill, wrapped in silence so deep and still that he could hear like a centennial's tread the watchful night wind as they went creeping along from tent to tent, seeming to whisper, all is well. A moment only he feels the spell of the place and the hour and the secret dread of the lonely belfry and the dead. For suddenly all his thoughts are bent on the shadowy something far away, where the river widens to meet the bay, in a line of black that bends and floats on the rising tide like a bridge of boats. Meanwhile, impatient to mount and ride, booted and spurred with a heavy stride, on the opposite shore walked Paul Revere. Now he patted his horse's side, now he gazed at the landscape far and near, then impetuous stamped the earth, and turned and tightened his saddle girth. But mostly he watched with eager search the belfry tower of the old North Church, as it rose above the graves on the hill, lonely and spectral and somber and still. And lo, as he looked on the belfry's height, a glimmer then a gleam of light. He springs to the saddle, the bridle he turns, but lingers and gazes till full on his sight a second lamp in the belfry burns.
A hurry of hoofs in a village street, a shape in the moonlight, a bulk in the dark, and beneath the trembles in passing, a spark struck out by a steed flying fearless and fleet. That was all, and yet through the gloom of the light, the fate of a nation was riding that night, and struck out by that steed in his flight, kindled the land into flame with its heat. He has left the village and mounted the steep, and beneath him, tranquil and broad and deep, is the mystic meeting the ocean tides, and under the alders that skirt its edge, now soft on the sand, now loud on the ledge, is heard of the tramp of his steed as he rides.
It was 12 by the village clock when he crossed the bridge into Medford town. He heard the crowing of the cock and the barking of the farmer's dog, and felt the damp of the river fog that rises after the sun goes down. It was 1 by the village clock when he galloped into Lexington. He saw the gilded weathercock swim in the moonlight as he passed, and the meeting house windows, black and bare, gaze at him with a spectral glare, as if they already stood aghast at the bloody work they would soon look upon. It was 2 by the village clock when he came to the bridge in Concord town. He heard the bleating of the flock and the twitter of the birds in the trees, and felt the breath of the morning breeze blowing over the meadow brown. And one was safe asleep in his bed, who at the bridge would be first to fall, who that day would be lying dead, pierced by a British musket ball.
You know the rest in the books you have read, how the British regulars fired and fled, from how the farmers gave them ball for ball from behind each fence and farmyard wall, chasing the redcoats down the lane, then crossing the fields to emerge again, under the trees and at the turn of the road, only pausing to fire and load. So through the night rode Paul Revere, and so through the night went his cry of alarm to every Middlesex village and farm, a cry of defiance and not fear, a voice of dark in the darkness, a knock at the door, a word that shall echo forevermore. For born in the night wind of the past, through all our history, to the last, in the hour and darkness and peril and need, the people will waken to listen to hear the hurrying hoofbeats of that steed in the midnight message of Paul Revere.
Before we bring up our last recital of a poem, let's bid adieu as he heads off to every Middlesex village and farm. Goodbye to Paul Revere, Captain Riala, the Lancers. Thank you. Big cheer. Folks, we have one more poem. We beg your indulgence. These kids are fantastic.
Okay, as Paul heads off, it's probably best that he doesn't hear this anyway. Ruth Anna is going to actually read what I consider my favorite poem, because this is actually the historical fact. Paul never made it to Concord, but she's going to read the poem about who did. So again, Ruth Anna, if you could come up again to read the poem, which she will tell you the name of.
Okay, the last poem here today. Okay, the last poem here today is called The Midnight Ride of William Dawes by Helen F. Moore. I am a wandering, bitter shade. Never of me was a hero made. Poets have never sung my praise. Nobody crowned my brow with bays. And if you ask me the fatal cause, I only answer, my name was Dawes. 'Tis all very well for the children to hear of the midnight ride of Paul Revere. But why should my name be quite forgot? Who rode as boldly as well, God wot? Why should I ask? The reason is clear. My name is Dawes, and his Revere. When the lights from the old North Church flashed out, Paul Revere was waiting about. But I was already on my way in the shadows of a night cold and gray. As I rode with never a break or pause, but what was the use? For my name was Dawes. History rings with his silvery name. Close to me are portrayals of fame. Had he been Dawes and I Revere, no one would ever have heard of him, I fear. No one had ever heard of me because he was Revere and I was Dawes.
Thank you all to our students of the Somerville Public Schools for their heroic and historic readings today. And hopefully you've all enjoyed the readings, and now you can go back and enjoy some more refreshments, play some games. And thank you so much for coming out today and celebrating our 242nd anniversary of Paul Revere's ride.
Please join me in thanking the Somerville Historic Commission and Brandon Wilson for what they do year-long to help us embrace our historic past, our origins, our roots, and to celebrate our history. Let's give them a round of applause. Also to the Somerville Department of Public Works, the DPW, Frank Santangelo is here, but Stan Cody, Ricky Roulette, all who prepared the event, put up the stage, and support these events. Thank you very much. And we're going to hear... We'll ask the Somerville High School Band if they'll give us another song sometime this morning before we head out. But enjoy the day. Have an incredible Patriots Day. I'm going to ask Brandon to come back up, close it out, and really have a great time all week long with your family.
I just want to make sure that, as the mayor so said before, this is the 175th anniversary of the town of Somerville separating from Charlestown. And in commemoration of that, today we have free temporary tattoos to give out to everybody that's here today. So if you didn't get one already, go over to the table, which is where the prizes are for the kids, and get your temporary tattoo. Wear it with pride. You can put it on and you can wash it off thereafter. Again, I'd also like to thank all the local businesses that have contributed to today's event in Red Bones, Dunkin' Donuts, the Somerville Stop and Shop, and When Pigs Fly. Without their participation and donations, we wouldn't have had any food today. So thanks again.